Dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I'm very glad to be with you tonight, inshallah, and I ask Allah to accept from us all, inshallah. Do you know what is the biggest problem for humans in this contemporary time, in this era? What is the biggest problem for humans? It is adopting the secular way of life. This is the biggest than any other challenge, financial, like, or economic, or social, or whatever. Adopting the secular way of life is the biggest problem challenging humans in this contemporary life, because that excludes the religion from their life. That excludes Allah's teachings from their life. That exposes them directly to their own mind and desire and so on. That's why we have a lot of, like, war and dispute and, you know, trouble between people. The only way to get peace on the globe is that people believe in one God, in Allah, and cooperate to please Him, and to build a guided civilization on the globe. One of the fruit of the secular way of life is, I'm a good person, why do I need God? This is the belief of non-Muslims. They defend it, they adopt it in their life, but also a lot of Muslims who are praying and fasting, they are adopting the secular way of life because of the, you know, big, lack of knowledge, of, you know, Islamic knowledge or proper knowledge. A lot of Muslims, they don't tell you, I reject the Allah's guidance. They say, I adopt it. But in their application, in the day-to-day life, they don't. And that's the biggest problem. That's where, you know, the point is came to the, you know, to Muslims. So this statement, is it correct? Is this question valid or, like, relevant? What does this statement reflect? We're going to, you know, see the answer while going on in the you know, talk, inshallah, azza wa jal. But this definitely, this question reflects that you don't know yourself as a human being. And you don't know your Lord, your Creator. You don't know Him. That's why you think that, you know, you may not need Him. In fact, you cannot even exist without Him. So we need first to know Allah, the Creator, the Provider, the Sustainer. We should know Him. He's the Creator. He's who is providing for you, and He's who is sustaining you. Also to know ourselves as Allah's creation. And we should know also the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around us. And we want to take a look on our life away from Allah's teaching, or away from God. If we do this properly, this will lead to believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the three major levels, the oneness of Lordship, the oneness of divinity, and the oneness of names and attributes. And if we believe in Him properly in these areas of Tawheed, then we are going to apply His teachings on life, His teachings in life with love. And we'll be so eager to do so, because we know that we cannot go anywhere without that. How to know the God, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Of course, the, you know, translation of God is not relevant. But if we say the God, you know, we understand that's only one God, and He is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we know Him through the creation around us, and also, you know, through ourselves, as I said, and also the teachings of the prophets. So these are the three ways how to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you think properly with the tools that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to you, you use properly your brain, your mind, your reason in thinking about this perfect creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, very precise, very perfect, very, very nice, where there is no room for chance at all. It is created within a very, very appropriate system. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you know, He said, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِ بِرَبِّكَ أَنَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. We will show them our signs in the horizons and within themselves until it becomes clear to them that it is the truth. We'd like to take a look at the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the horizons. Again, in the Quran we find a lot of ayat, a lot of verses that direct you and guide you to look around you in this creation and in yourself to reach the level of certainty, to be certain about Allah's existence and that this creator is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُوقِنِينَ وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And in the earth are signs for the ones having certainty. And in yourselves, do you then not behold? When we look about what is called the Big Bang, and we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. This statement could not be said from anyone else except the Creator himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how is he going to know this before like 14th century? He will never be able to, because big scholars nowadays, they started discovering the Big Bang in 1930s as like the first theory. And then in around 64, they completed that theory and that became a reality. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about us about that in the Quran, as you know. Let's take a look at our solar system. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْنَا السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا لَاعِبِينَ. And in the other ayah, وَمَا خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاءَ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا بَاطِلًا. And in the other ayah, إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, you know, heavens and earth for a purpose, for a reason. He's not playing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He created that with the truth. Let's see how big and huge is this creation, because the scholars are saying that there is a rule taken from the Quran. الاستدلال بتوحيد الربوبية على توحيد الألوهية. Meaning to use the oneness of lordship as a proof for the oneness of divinity or worship. If the creation is so big and so huge and so perfect, meaning that the Creator is perfect, is wise, full of wisdom, and He's so, we should glorify Him and worship Him. If we look at the distance between the planets within our galaxy, just our galaxy, we are going to see that there are like billions of galaxies, billions. We are not talking about tens or hundreds or thousands or millions. We are talking about billions of galaxies The smallest among them is our solar system. So let's take a look about the distance between planets within this smallest galaxy in Allah's creation. Now this distance is in millions of miles. So between Mercury and the Sun, the distance is 36 million miles. 36 million miles. Venus, 63 million miles. Earth, between Earth and Sun is 93 million miles. 150 million kilometers. 150 million kilometers. You know, and so on till you go to the last one, 30,700 million miles. Can you even imagine that? And this is where? In this small solar system. Let's take another, like a bigger look. The diameter of our galaxy, the smallest one, its diameter is 5 billion kilometers. 5 billion, the diameter of our galaxy. The age of Earth is 4,600 million years. 4,600 million years. Mira is a star, and that star, we are going to take, you know, some distance outside our galaxy. Mira is not in our galaxy. Mira star is 64 million times bigger than our sun. 64 million, brothers and sisters. This star is 64 million times bigger than our sun. Something that, you know, even your brain stops, cannot even think about that huge distance. The closest star to us from the seventh heaven, you know there are seven heavens, right? Samawat al-Saba. Alhamdulillah, this is now proved at the level of like science and astronomy, and scholars are talking about that. So the closest star to us from that the seventh heaven is 17 billion light years. You do the math later on, inshallah. You know, 17 billion light years. One light year is around 6 trillion miles. 6 trillion miles. One light year. What about 17 billion light years? The second heaven, Sama al-Thaniya, you know, makes a full round around our galaxy. You know, because Allah says, وَكُلٌ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ. So the second galaxy, the second heaven, makes a full round around our galaxy in 250 million light years. One round. 250 million light years. Just to know how big is Allah's creation, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above that. And so if we know that one light year is around 6 trillion miles, you just do the math if you can. So these huge planets are very beautiful in shape. The shape is very beautiful, very perfect in their mission. They will never make accident. And very precise in movements. One of the scholars I was listening to, he said, if you want to think about the possibility of crash between planets, which is zero, of course, look, if we have two ants, the Dhubabatan, one is in Cairo, and the other one is in Washington, D.C. Two ants. Are they going to crash? Impossible. So the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so big, where all these planets are swimming, and the distance between them is in millions of miles. As we said earlier, the closest was to the sun was 36 million miles. So we humans, we are driving our cars, trying to be careful, and we are making thousands of accidents every day. So Allah's creation is so perfect. Now let's take a look at the number of galaxies. We said that our galaxy is the smallest one. According to NASA, the number of galaxies is over 150 billion. 150 billion. Each of which has hundreds of billions of stars. Now, a recent German supercomputer simulation put that number even higher at 500 billion instead of 150. 500 billion galaxies. You know, that's something that you cannot even like think about it. You know, 500 billion galaxies, each one has hundreds of billions of stars. They said heaven too has, by itself, has 400 million suns. You know, when you compare it to our galaxy that has only one sun, right? عندنا شمس واحدة. السماء الثانية تسمى المجرة. I don't know what's the name in English. But السماء الثانية هي المجرة. And it has over than 400,000 million suns. Allahu Akbar. If we have, you know, one sun, look at the second heaven, how many suns it has. The length of heaven too. Heaven number two is 100,000 light years. The length of that heaven or galaxy, you know, big galaxy that includes a lot of galaxies in it, just the length of it is 100,000 light years. And we said that one light year is how much? 6 trillion miles. طيب. You know, heaven number six is 100 trillion times bigger than heaven number two. Heaven number two is 100,000 light years. Heaven number six is 100 trillion times bigger than that. So just, you know, think about Allah's creation, how big it is. This is what we have discovered so far, what scholars discovered so far. Much more is coming because the universe is continuously expanding. This is now a fact, a scientific fact. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. And the heaven, we have built it with power, and surely we are indeed extending it wide. بِأَيْدٍ هُنَا أَيْ بِقُوَّ مِنَ الْأَيْدِ وَهُوَ الْقُوَّةِ يقال أيدك الله يعني قواك مش بأيدي يعني بمعنى اليد. And look now about this billions of like, you know, galaxies and stars and things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above his creation. When you remember what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just to get a small look about you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وما قدر الله حق قدره والأرض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامة والسماوات مطويات بيمينه سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. So if we saw that, you know, these billions of miles or light years, and they are all swimming in this like empty, you know, space circles, subhanallah, you just get amazed how big is Allah's creation. And that it is, of course, Allah is bigger than that, and he's controlling all of that. And in the day of judgment, you know, the whole earth and the, you know, the heavens will be folded in his hand. And the Prophet ﷺ says, there is a very amazing hadith. I wanted you to know that what scholars are discovering these days, you can easily see through this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ gave us an idea about that. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, مَا السَّمَوَاتُ السَّبْعُ فِي الْكُرْسِي إِلَّا كَحَلَقَةٍ مُلْقَاتٍ بِأَرْضِ فَلَاتٍ وَفَضْلُ الْعَرْشِ عَلَى الْكُرْسِي كَفَضْلِ تِلْكَ الْفَلَاتِ عَلَى تِلْكَ الْحَلَقَةِ. I'm going to try to translate this hadith. So the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, the seven heavens compared to the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is like a ring when you throw it in a huge desert. So what's the size of the seven heavens compared to Allah's kursi? It's nothing. Then when you compare between the kursi and the arsh of Allah, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so he said that, you know, the kursi is like a ring in a desert compared to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is just to get an idea about Allah's creation, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the ummah an idea. This is a treasure for the ummah. Also, we want to take a look about the size of the angels. You know, the Prophet ﷺ one time said, I saw Gabriel in his real shape. And وَقَدْ سَدَّ الْأُفُقُ. He's like covering the whole horizon, and he has 600 wings. And he said here, صلى الله عليه وسلم, أذن لي أن أحدث عن ملك من حملة العرش. رجلاه في الأرض السفلى وعلى قرنه العرش وبين شحمة أذنه وعاتقه خفقان الطير 700 سنة يقول الملك سبحانك حيث كنت. هذا حديث حسن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, you know, Allah gave me permission to talk about one of the angels. And this angel, his legs are in the seventh, in the lower land, lower earth. And his, like, you know, al-qarnayn, his horns are under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the distance between his ear and his al-atiq, you know, his like shoulder, is when the bird is flying so fast for 700 years. 700 years. One angel from the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is like a bird traveling 700 years in a high speed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about, you know, how these planets are, you know, swimming in the space. They are all swimming in a very like precise and perfect way. So he says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ كُلُّمْ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ. All of them are running in this orbit. And in the other ayah, وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ بِحُسْبَانَ. The sun and the moon move by precise calculation. So everything is calculated precisely. Let's take a look about, you know, the wind and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring rain to us. So we think, you know, now when people, you know, study these things, they talk about the physical phenomena without talking about who is behind that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَصْرِيفِ الرِّيَاحِ وَالسَّحَابِ الْمُسَخَّرِ بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْقِلُونَ. So, in this wind who is moving, and this, cloud who is accumulating, and then the rain, there are signs for people who use their brains. Then look to the signs in the air, how these birds are flying. In fact, when you think about the like creation of like airplanes or automobiles, or they are all taken from Allah's creation around us. So humans are taking these signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His rules in the universe to benefit from it to better in our lives. And then look to the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ بِغَيْرِ عَمَدٍ تَرَوْنَهَا وَأَلْقَى فِي الْأَرْضِ رَوَاسِيَ أَنْ تَمِيدَ بِكُمْ وَبَثَّ فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ دَابَّةٍ وَأَنْزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ زَوْجٍ بَهِيجٍ. Look, subhanallah, these heavens are without pillars or without seen pillars. The two tafsir. Either with no pillars or with pillars that you cannot see. Which one is like more i'jaz in it? Both, subhanallah. Both. It's either with pillars or with pillars, without pillars or with pillars that you cannot see. Both are at the highest level of i'jaz, subhanallah. But let's quickly take a quick look about signs within ourselves. Look, subhanallah, about the creation, our creation. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ سُلَالَةٍ مِنْ طِينٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُطْفَةً فِي قَرَارٍ مَكِينٍ ثُمَّ خَلَقْنَا النُطْفَةَ عَلَقَةً فَخَلَقْنَا الْعَلَقَةَ مُضْغَةً فَخَلَقْنَا الْمُضْغَةَ عِظَامًا فَكَسَوْنَا الْعِظَامَ لَحْمًا ثُمَّ أَنْشَأْنَاهُ خَلْقًا آخَرَ فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Who taught Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم this before 14 centuries? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look to the perfect creation where you are taken care of, and these cycles, they are moving. And before that, they are saying that, of course, they have the ovule of the woman and the sperms of the man. Millions of sperms are running to the ovule, and only one will be able to, or to the one who will reach first is going to be the reason of your creation. Then look, subhanallah, to the three folds of darkness of the humans. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about this in the Quran. How Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would know that? And this is just discovered very recently. Look to our systems. How very precise are them? What's the difference between the ear, the eye, and the heart in the tissue or in the like the cells? It is the same. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this the ability to hear, and gave this the ability to see and to look and to differentiate between colors. Look at your tongue. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it differentiate between the hot and the cold, between the salty and the sweet. Subhanallah. It is the same muscle, but it is differentiating between all these things. Then it differentiates between the B and the C, and the D and the F, the letters. Allahu Akbar. وَاخْتِلَافِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ. The difference in our, like the way we speak and tongue, and our colors, those are signs of Allah's power, wisdom, existence, of course, and so on. Look to the supercomputer, the human's brain. In the Quran, you find a lot of ayat, a lot of verses, guiding you to use this brain. Use it. Use it perfectly. Use it to know Allah. Use it to worship Him. Use it to better your life and so on. But a lot of people are like animals. إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَصُمُّ الْبُكْمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. So the worst of moving living creatures with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the deaf and the damned, those who are not mindful. The people who eliminate this grace, this ni'mah, are like animals, subhanallah. And look to the, you know, when you look closer to the tissue and the muscles, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that, you know, created you and made that very like strong and very perfect. نَحْنُ خَلَقْنَاهُمْ وَشَدَدْنَا أَسْرَهُمْ وَإِذَا شِئْنَا بَدَّلْنَا أَمْثَالَهُمْ تَبْدِيلًا. Look to the, you know, your skeletal system. أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَلَّا نَجْمَعْ عِظَامَهُ. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, assembled your bones in a way that gave you dignity. You know, you are the only creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has this like perfect way how to move and still keep your dignity standing up. Now look to the all the systems. These are just flashes to remember Allah's, you know, bounties on us. When you have this very beautiful digesting system, you eat, then this manufacturer will differentiate between what's good for you and what's bad, and also will take whatever your body needs, and we exclude what you don't need, and so on. It is a miracle. Wherever you look, it is a miracle. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We have truly created the human in the finest constitution. Look to these, all these kind of like veins and arteries, and you know the compatibility between them and how they help each other. And it is subhanallah. So let's now, after knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator and he's so great, we saw how big is his creation. So now you could imagine, you could easily imagine that the globe, the earth where we live, it is not even a dot in Allah's creation. It is not even a dot. Where we, in fact, I was, you know, reading about this, you know, galaxies and so on. And one of the scientists here said that some galaxies are within like the whole creation. Galaxies are like dots. A dot of light. You just see a dot of light. So what about the earth? Now what about me and you on this earth? We are nothing. So why do we fight each other? Why do we try to steal from each other? Why can't we just live in peace together and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So let's take a look. How are we doing if we think that we don't need God? How are we doing? Now there are some questions that, you know, everyone should answer within himself. Are we really happy? Are humans happy? Like, of course, individuals, families, communities, societies. Are we safe? Just wherever you go, there are crimes everywhere. Of course, in Muslim countries and non-Muslim countries, it is the same. Are we secure? Are we healthy? Do we have peaceful minds? Do we feel the tranquility in our hearts? Are we spiritually content and satisfied? All these questions, you know, the answer is, everyone should answer it between himself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the majority of people on the globe are not. Even Muslims who are not understanding well their creed, their aqidah, their belief. Because if you understand it well and live upon the Sharia guidance, you will be flying. You will be very happy. So if we don't have that, we really have problems here and there, all of us. Okay, the FBI National Data Crime Statistics now. This is the 2012 crime clock statistics. Let's take a look about, you know, at the like most civilized country on the globe. A violent crime occurred every 1 day, month, 1 minute. No, it is every 26 seconds. One murder every 35.4 minutes. Murder. A human life is taken in this country at that year every 35.4 minutes. One forcible rape every 6.2 minutes. Every 6.2 minutes, a girl is destroyed psychologically and physically. One robbery every 1.5 minutes. One robbery every 1.5 minutes. One aggravated assault every 41.5 seconds. So the crimes are counts per seconds and minutes. A property crime occurred every 3.5 seconds. One burglary every 15 seconds. One larceny theft every 5.1 seconds. One motor vehicle theft every 43.7 seconds. You know, numbers are talking. Over 1.1 million people live with HIV/AIDS in the USA, and this is, you know, the estimated adult diagnosed with AIDS per 100,000 people in different states. Family and society. Family is suffering so high because of this secular system. Percentage of marriages ending in divorce, 60%. This is very humble. In fact, it is. People are saying it is more than that. Percentage of cheating spouses, 70%. 77.6% of college students are having sexual affairs. More than four children die every day, four children die as a result of child abuse. About 20% of students aged 12 to 18 reported that gangs were present at their school during the school year. 7.44% reported being threatened or injured with a weapon on school property one or more times. Even schools are not safe. And of course, you heard this like a couple of last years, you know, killing at schools and so on. Up to 8.3% of adolescents in the United States suffer from depression, the sickness of the era. Male suicide rate around 22 per 100,000. Female suicide rate around 5 per 100,000. Other ailments caused by ignoring Allah's teaching, like of course domestic abuse and homelessness, with a lot of things that people are neglecting. But these people, these homeless people, are humans, and they are homeless. And, you know, of course, you know what that means. Rape statistics. One out every six American women has been the victim of an attempted or completed rape in her lifetime. About 3% of American men, or one in 33, have experienced an attempted or completed rape in their lifetime. 50% of sexual assault and rape victims are under age 12. Cannot even imagine it. Under age 12. 7% of girls in grades 5th to 8th grades and 12% of girls in grades 9 to 12 said they had been sexually abused. Let's see what's happening to these victims. 3 times or more likely to suffer from depression, people who are sexually abused or assaulted. 6 times more likely to suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. 13 times more likely to abuse alcohol. 26 times more likely to abuse drugs. 4 times more likely to contemplate suicide. So all these are, you know, results of living within the secular way, away from Allah's teaching, our relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, these are basics that every Muslim know, but we should from time to time go back to the basics. It's very, very scary and dangerous to forget the basics and to cut off yourself from that and leave away from it. So Allah created humans for one purpose only, to worship Him. This should be very well known. But of course, we should understand the meaning of worship. It's not only this, it's not the secular way. Worship does not mean prayer or fasting. Every single activity in your life should be based on Allah's teaching. So that's the comprehensive way of worship. Building your house or like working, it's a worship. Taking away the dirt from the street is a worship. Helping your neighbor is a worship. Cleaning, you know, the street or whatever is a worship. So we should understand it that way, and that's the Islamic way to understand the comprehensive way of worship. We came to this life without our will. Who came to this life with his own will? And we will live it without our will as well. So we have to be sure about that. You are going to be taken away from this life without your will. So you have to be ready for that. Allah granted us the mental ability to think, so we can make a choice to act properly in order to be happy and build a good life. You have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the reason to differentiate between good and bad. And if you don't use it properly, the emotion will win over the reason, and then your life will be messed up because you are going to be, you know, falling into shahawat, desire. Because the main reasons of being astray or away from the straight path are two major reasons. The shahawat, desire, and shubuhat, like being confused at the level of an intellectual level or aqidah level and so on. Allah gave us dignity and power over all other creation. Humans are the denominators on this globe. And Allah put all the other creation at your service. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْ. So He made everything at your service. Just use it correctly and properly. And He sent us His teachings. He did not leave us alone with this reason. He gave us teachings that we will never be good without it. Allah knows His creation. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. And He knows that we will never be able to make our own laws. Never. And that's why we are not happy. That's why we are not safe away from Allah. That's why we have all these crimes. That's why we have all this war. Because we will never be able to achieve a law, a human law, that will be good for us. And this is, you know, humans do not take the lesson. Look back to the history. You will never find any society or country or living in peace or like a good life without Allah's teachings. And we are continuing. Instead of stopping and thinking, using properly this brain, saying that I came here without my will. Someone created me. This one who created these perfect universes, galaxies, and made everything under my service, He's the one who deserves to be worshipped. And to him, I'm going to go back. So, you know, Allah's teachings are in our favor. And this is something that we always should emphasize about it. A lot of people think that, you know, Allah's teachings are to tie us. No. مَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want in any way to put hardships on us. Never. In fact, He wants to make things easier for us instead of us digging and trying. Look how you know, the amount of time wasted and the amount of money and salaries and humans sitting there trying to make rules, laws. And how many, like, wealth and big amounts of money we are wasting because we are not following Allah's laws, and we have AIDS and this kind of big, like, sicknesses that are costing us a big fortune. Why should we waste this money? We can't avoid that just by following Allah's law. So it is impossible to exist without Allah, of course, and we are in a big absolute need for Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot even blink our eyes without Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need the air He's providing for us. We need the food. We need, you know, the water. We need everything He's providing for us. We cannot be without Him. So we need Him physically for our physical needs. And we need Him for our day-to-day life. And we need Him for our system life. You know, His laws, the Sharia laws, are very important to humans. And we cannot live properly without that. This is what, you know, most people nowadays do not understand and do not know. Even some Muslims who failed into the trap of the secular way of life. Of course, we all know, Muslims know, that this life is a test, or it is a testing period, and it is very limited. Allah gave us the ability to act in a free way. Do whatever you want. He gave you the tools to differentiate between the good and the bad. He showed you the path, the straight path and the other paths. But you are free to do whatever you want. But you are totally responsible on your choices. Life is not limited to this life. In fact, this life is the shortest among our life, the big life. This life is the shortest. You are going to live here how many years? 60, 70, 80, 100, over 100. How many years you are going to stay in the grave? Maybe thousands of years. And then the hereafter is limitless. Limitless. Okay, now if you sell the hereafter for this life, meaning that you are not even mindful. It's like if we have 24 hours and someone is telling you, okay, you have 1 hour, do whatever you want to do in this hour, and based on what you are doing, the rest of the day, you are going to be, you know, put in, you have two doors, either this door to like good life or this door to bad life. And you choose. Every single like one who is mindful, he is going to say, I'm going to do whatever you tell me in order to be in that good door. And they are giving some, like scholars are giving some like examples, saying, for example, you know, they are talking about a virtual state where people choose our king or our ruler every like 3 years. And since day one, when they choose him, they take him to a desert and tell him, this is your place after the 3 years. During these three years, you are the king. You are the ruler. Do whatever you want. After these 3 years, we are going to take you, force you to go and live there, and you cannot get out of it. So the wise rulers are going to, within these 3 years, going to rule the state, and between time to time, they are going to put, to prepare a house for themselves in that desert, where they are going to be taken after these 3 years. But the people of desire, they are going to live, you know, their own way, and they will forget about that desert till the last day, and they are going to be taken there. They are going to, of course, be destroyed there. So wise people should think, you know, deeply about the short time we are living. And of course, we are seeing people dying every day. And it is my turn and your turn any day soon. Even if it is like after 50 years or 30 or 40, it is soon compared to this huge, like, you know, number of years. So we can never be good without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and without His guidance. To Him we belong and to Him we shall return. We open the floor for some questions or comments or addition if you have something to add, inshallah.
If you can just elaborate the exact difference in the language, what will it be, or description.
And then the ayah about the Big Bang, in what surah?
The ayah of the Big Bang.
There's an ayah in distress. So I think what you shared today is really great, especially for the kids, because scientifically they kind of really grasp things a lot easier. But how you kind of connect this ayah, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ, always in distress.
Kabad is not stress, in fact. It is like effort. It's like exercising an effort to achieve. This is a very good point, in fact.
Allah created humans that when they move, when they work, they feel better psychologically, they are healthier physically. And they achieve something for themselves. But if you do not move, if you do not exercise efforts, you are going to be attacked by more sicknesses. So that's why they are saying there are some kind of sicknesses for rich people who are eating a lot of meat. They have maids working, doing things for them. So this is fi kabad, meaning that human should work. Human should exercise efforts.
A human should achieve. You should not just sit and wait for others to serve you or to work for you. That's not good for you, not only financially, it is also psychologically and, you know, physically at the level of your health. So it is not stress. In fact, it is the effort that you should put, المشقة يعني المكابدة بمعنى بعد الجهد لتحصيل النفع يعني. طيب for العرش والكرسي you know, من الناحية الشرعية ما تستطيع تتصور يعني you cannot you know, imagine what's related to Allah's names and attributes and so on. But linguistically, and it is in some hadith that الكرسي موضع القدمين. الكرسي موضع القدمين والعرش هو سرير الملك. So this is من الناحية اللغوية. لكن من الناحية الشرعية الله أعلم. يعني المعنى معلوم لكن كيف نجهله كما يقول العلماء.
مرحبا جزاك الله خير
وياك ان شاء
الله very very interesting الحمد لله very telling المعجزات الكبرى تاع الله سبحانه وتعالى just a couple of things and I am very interested in these subjects and I look at a lot of you know studies and
it is very important to you know, to think about this always and to try to learn more because this is a way to increase your iman. When you see the, you know, Allah's creation is so perfect and so precise and so being, yani subhanallah, it is, you know, something that makes you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more and, you know, ask Him for protection and for provision more.
So one of the things I was listening recently, just 2 weeks ago, on the National Geographic, and you were talking about how do you see the world ending?
How the world
will end. And among other things that he said, is that this whole solar system will go back and encamish. And through that, I can feel four episodes, for Abu Halaqat. And I was listening to them one by one, and there was, in my head, reciting ayat from the Quran, ayat kulla fi al-suwar li Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yatahata fi ala nihayat hada al-alam. يعني أنا كين كثير من الأشياء اللي تقالت يعني ذاك البرنامج اللي تشوف فيها في معجزة الله سبحانه وتعالى كثيرة. فهنا you talk a lot about the creation, but I think there is also that aspect of how the world ends, and there is many ayats in the Quran that you know goes to that aspect as well, which is among the other big mu'ajizats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah, that's another subject. We may talk about it inshallah another time, but in summary, you know, the creation of Allah started with that big bang, right? It used to be like a grain and then you know, expanded. The end of the world will be the opposite phenomena. It will go back to that, you know, stage. And these stars, of course, there are a lot of stars now that are dying. And even because of the distance and because of the you know, we should study also about, you know, the light phenomena. We still can see some lights for some stars that they are like they vanished like hundreds of years back, but we can still see the light, which is subhanallah mu'jiza, because you know the light, you cannot see the light if it is not going against an object and it goes in the darkness. This light goes always, and it is sirat al-dawl, and it is like, you know, it has a speed, and it is going, till it reaches like a planet, or, you know, for example, the moon. The moon does not have light, but we see that light because of the reflection of the light of the sun. Same thing for the earth, and so on.
One more thing, Sama'i al-Tariq wa ma'adhanak al-Tariq al-Najm al-Saqim. Among other things that I listened to, and that was just recently discovered. Recently discovered, and I forget the name of it, but that's how you describe it. Najm al-Thaqib, the star that basically perforates everything that goes through.
Subhanallah, yani, almost every, almost yani, the earth of the creation is discovered, but still there are, you know, few ayat that are not discovered, and we still, subhanAllah, the knowledge and the information, the Quran is more advanced than what they discovered so far.
JazakAllah khair, ya Sheikh. Just to be practical, we looked at a lot of statistics, and it almost indicates that they're primarily in the Western world. And we always try to indicate that these things don't happen in the Muslim world.
No, we don't.
Well, we haven't seen any statistics through your presentation. I'm not trying to defeat anything.
Yeah.
I'm trying to ask you a question. How do we reconcile the fact that a person comes and says, people who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also have inflictions. And they have just as much problems, but we don't report these problems. Because whoever it is that is dedicated with the responsibility to report these problems, they don't put them out. So I'm trying to find out, when we engage others who do ask, why do we need Allah, whether we need Allah or not, how do we reconcile the fact of these statistics that Muslims also get inflicted?
Yeah.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, JazakAllah khair. If you remember from the beginning, when I talked in that introduction, I said that, you know, this is the belief and the saying of non-Muslims, but a lot of Muslims are living this situation.
Right.
And I brought statistics from here because it is available, and because we are living here, and because it is where people say, I'm doing good, I don't need God. In the Islamic world, we have a lot of problems. It's not as like severe as here, but we still have them. But unfortunately, we don't have exact documentation yet. It's not, a lot of people, they don't report it, as you said. Also, governments are not, you know, taking care of that. But here, information is power, as they say, and they collect everything, which is very good, and that's part of their power. So I personally wish that we can find real statistics and correct from the Muslim world, because we have AIDS, for example, but we don't have the true, the reality of the number, the correct number of people. We have rape, we have, of course, murder, we have everything. So Muslims nowadays, most of them, I say most of them, are not following the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are not understanding it, because if they do, we should not have all these problems. We have ignorance. So now, when you go and ask a question, like a basic question, in any Muslim community in a Muslim country, you don't find the correct answer. So we have a problem of knowledge, and we always say that. The Quran started with Iqra, read. And he mentioned the pen and the human being, the axle of the educational, like, you know, system. So that we learn. Now we don't learn. Look at any country, where do you find, like, Islamic country, where do you find, like, Islamic curriculum? You know, maybe Saudi Arabia, and like from grade, first grade, but in most of the world, it is secular. They start with, I'm talking about like my country, for example, Tunisia, when we studied elementary school and so on, we don't used to have these things. Like, they call it Tarbiyah al-Islamiyya, or like Islamic education, and it is like, you know, when you grow up a little bit, and it is 0.5, the power of it compared to like 4 and 6 for like math and science and so on. And people used to make fun from the teacher of this class, because this teacher is chosen in a good way that will be like a source of fun for the students. It is sad, but this is the reality. So most countries, some countries, we have problems of knowledge. Islamic knowledge is not taken care of in an appropriate way. نعم. طيب نكتفي بهذا القدر إن شاء الله. أحمد تفضل تحب تقول شيء؟ جزاكم الله خير for listening. May Allah bless you and protect you إن شاء الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.